Welcome to CivilNet. My guest today is Viken Chaterian, who is an analyst, a journalist, author of the recent From Perestroika to Rainbow Revolutions, and also author of the upcoming book in the early part of 2015 called The Open Wound, Armenians, Turks, and a Century of Genocide. We can't begin to say how relevant both of those titles are to what we want to talk about today. Viken, thank you for giving us time on CivilNet.
Thank you, Safi, for the invitation.
And from Geneva, you wrote a great piece for Open Democracy, to which we're going to give a link, on not just the recent events in Kisab, but really the reactions to the recent events in Kisab, the reactions from those who are the Assad publicists, those who back the rebel forces, Turkey, and of course Armenians. I don't even know where to begin, because this was obviously a shakeup, perhaps one we should have foreseen, but at the same time, the reactions were so telling and so hard to explain. Let's start with one of your assertions that this is perhaps the first time in the 3 years of this misery that Armenians have been outright associated with the Assad forces. Is that right?
Yes, it is. I mean, my take is that Armenians worldwide, before listening to the Kisab Armenians, they started a campaign saying that this is horrible, this is a genocide, that Turkey is responsible for what's happening. So basically what the Armenians did was to react to Turkey without considering that what was happening in Kisab was also the result of a horrible war taking place in Syria. So they completely disregarded the Syria context, and they simply based their discourse, their campaign, Save Kisab, as if the only actors there were Turks on the one side and Armenians on the other side. Which, in a way, it was true. You know, there are Turks, there are Armenians. Turkey is a player in the Syria conflict. They have impact, they have influence, they support the opposition, they support the opposition fighters. And it is true that the majority of the Kisab population who were displaced, they are Armenians. But, I mean, this is only a small part of the story.
Let's, for the record, say that no one in Kisab was killed.
But no one was killed, no one was wounded.
But let's also, understanding the reactions to the Turkey factor in this, let's please talk about not just why this is historically or politically a problem, but in the context of the Kisab Armenians and the Damascus Armenians and the Aleppo Armenians, why this kind of reaction is not long-term helpful? Isn't that a fair question?
Yes, I mean, there's a war going on in Syria, and there's one side, which is the government, the Syrian government, the Syrian regime, and there's a multitude of other sides. I would even dare to say that today, those who are fighting on the side of the government, even they are not unified. So there's a very complex reality, and this is a long-term conflict.
And in that process, Armenians have what, both been pawns and victims?
I mean, Armenians are victims, like the rest of the Syrian population. I would say that, yes, even there are other sectors of the Syrian population who have suffered enormously more than the Armenians. So let's not take the Syria question as an Armenia-only question. It is not. And in this war, the Armenian church, political community leaders said, we are neutral. We don't want to hurt any side of the Syrian people.
And why do you think they said that? I think that that message, unlike in the case of the Lebanese civil war, that message was loud, it was clear, and it was explained. I don't think that's the case in Syria. What do you say?
It's not the case in Syria, because in Syria, the regime never let any organization, whether church, political, community, NGOs, foundations, to have their voice. So this is a totalitarian regime which concentrates power in its own hands. So in Lebanon, we had parties, political parties, we had associations. So we had the experience of doing politics. We had the telephone numbers of all the sides. We had members in different political parties. In Syria, this was forbidden. So as a result, the Syrian-Armenian community does not have political maturity, does not have political experience. They did not know the opposition. It was forbidden to contact the opposition in any way up to the conflict, even afterwards. So as a result, the Syrian community has said we are neutral, and they kept silent. I understand their conditions. You know, they are not in a, in an easy condition. But when it comes to Armenian political parties, organizations, parliamentarians, state institutions outside, then this is a very different story. We have a very different responsibility. We are free to speak out. And we are free to say that Armenians should not be part of this conflict. In the best case, we should do a positive work, not a negative, destructive work. Destroying Syria is not our project. There are enough people destroying Syria. Let's try to build bridges in Syria.
You know, I think that even though some people are going to disagree with what you say, I think that there's going to be general interest in the following, that everything that is said and done by Armenians outside Syria, doesn't matter, is somehow being used, instrumentalized within Syria. And you who follow the Syrian press, the points made by the other sides, not just the regime, but all of the opposition groups, have the events and statements of the last 2-3 weeks been used, abused, instrumentalized by the rebel forces?
Well, the campaign that was launched afterwards and the position taken by the parliamentarian group who went to Damascus and Latakia, it was very much within the rhetoric of the Syrian regime. So we talked about terrorists, we talked about foreign agents, we accused Turkey of being responsible for what happened in Kesab. So in the context of the Syrian conflict, the campaign Save Kesab was very much, and rightly so, was seen to be part of the official propaganda of the Syrian regime. And I think this is very dangerous. Those who are doing such campaigns, they should be careful. And especially when this campaign was based on lies. When they were talking about Armenians being massacred, churches being destroyed, and so on. So,
Viken, you need to explain why this is dangerous. As far as the Save Kesab genuine campaigners are concerned, they completely and truly believe that they are using this to raise the ire of the French, the American, and I don't know which other governments, to what? I mean, how is it that this effort can possibly be bad for the Armenians of Syria?
Because in Syria, there are Armenians in different places. In Aleppo, in Kamishli, in Kesab, in Damascus, in Latakia, and elsewhere. And for Armenians in Syria, the fact that they are considered to be neutral by both sides, it's a kind of insurance, life insurance. It saves them. Every day, these people have to cross checkpoints, have to be asked, who are you? You are Armenian. Okay. And in case they are labeled by one side that the Armenians are working with the opposite side, this will make them targets. And Syria is a long-term conflict. Today, Armenians living in Aleppo and Damascus, they are in regions dominated by the regime. But this might change. So think about in a year, think about in 2 years, what might happen to them. So it's very good to care about Armenians in Kesab and to help them. But when you want to do help, don't hurt them. So pay attention to what you are doing.
Please, let's conclude by talking a little bit about Kesab, the Turkey proximity, and the role that Turkey now has. On the one hand, obviously committed to bringing down Assad. On the other hand, now probably very aware that not just Armenians, but the international community is paying serious attention to its perceived role, if not its actual role, either actual or perceived, regarding the Armenians in northern, northwestern Syria?
I mean, the Turkish government was conscious about the Armenian factor long ago. I can tell you that the mountains east of Kesab, Jebel Turkoman, was taken by the opposition, I think, in the second half of 2012. And I know for sure from sources in Turkey that the Turkish government was under pressure from international actors to take care of the Armenian presence on the other side of the border, as well as the Assyrian presence. So they were kind of approached by high-level European government officials, telling them, pay attention in your policies of the Armenian and Assyrian factors. And I know for sure that the Syrian the Turkish authorities had put pressure on rebel groups not to launch an attack on Kesab. No, you know, they could have done this a year ago. But things have changed. And what changed was basically related to internal power struggle in Turkey. Prime Minister Erdogan and his AKP party needed a victory because of internal considerations, as well as the fact that the Syrian opposition was losing major strategic points in southern Syria, all across the border with Lebanon. So this was mainly the result of changing policy in Ankara, and this was very obvious. The attack that took place in Kesab was very coordinated. Turkish military took part. They shot down a Syrian MiG-23 military plane, and this was obvious that there was Turkish participation. But it was not about the case of Armenians. It was because of internal Turkish and Syrian considerations.
And do you know? Do your sources say? Are they aware that the Armenian factor, although perhaps collateral damage alone, is not perceived that way and therefore not going to be publicized that way? Are they aware of the fallout?
Okay, the Save Kesab campaign showed that Armenians have a voice. Okay, they can be influential. They can be heard in Europe, in the States mainly, and elsewhere. But the way it was done, I think it was counterproductive, especially when we consider the situation inside Syria and the position of Armenians inside Syria.
Thank you. We are going to post a link to your long, very in-depth piece in Open Democracy on the Kesab attack and the fallout. And we hope to continue to speak to you again, as we have in the past, on developments in and around Syria, which of course continue to affect us all.
Thank you.
Thank you, Viken Chaterian, and thank you for following us on CivilNet.